Hello guys, how are you? I hope you all are doing fine and you are energetic as me. Okay. So in the previous chapter we discussed about Walther's law and we finished it with the numerical part also. And in this lecture we will be starting our lecture with the first theorem of welfare economics. Okay. So what does this theorem say? So this theorem says that all market equilibrium are Pareto efficient. Yes, this is the only statement this theorem gives. Now what we have to do is that we have to prove this statement. Okay, and it also means that market equilibrium will exhaust all grain from the trade. Okay, so let's prove this theorem. So how will we prove this theorem? First we will take the assumption that we used to do in the ninth class. Remember, we take one assumption that okay, this is not true, this is true. And at last, it doesn't come true. So we said that our assumption was false. So this theorem was applicable. Similarly, we do the same thing here. Okay. So suppose that we have a market equilibrium which is not Pareto efficient. Okay. It can be shown that this assumption leads to a logical contradiction. So this is the logical contradiction which we will be assuming that we have a market equilibrium which is not Pareto efficient. Okay, but it say all market equilibrium are Pareto efficient. So we are taking our contradicting assumption that we have a market equilibrium which is not Pareto efficient. Okay, so to say that market equilibrium is not Pareto efficient implies that there is some other allocation which is feasible and that allocation is preferred by both persons. Since see, this is for the rough diagram only. This is the Edgeworth box. I am saying this is my X preference. Okay, and this is the market equilibrium and it is Pareto efficient. Okay, so now I am saying that there is some market equilibrium which is not Pareto efficient and I prefer it from this X also. Let us say Y. Okay, we are taking Y in the Edgeworth box. So now what we will do? So this means that we have assumed that we have a market equilibrium which is not Pareto efficient. Okay, so we have assumed that Y is a market equilibrium and it is not Pareto efficient. So what will be the condition for first two market equilibrium? It will be same. Y1A plus Y1B is equal to W1A plus W1B, right? Similarly for good two, Y2A plus Y2B is equal to W2A plus W2B. Okay. Now there is some X allocation and Y is preferred over X and X is Pareto efficient. Okay. So now what will happen for person A? Y1A comma Y2A will be preferred over X1A comma X2A, right? Similarly for person B, Y2A comma Y2, wait, sorry, Y1A comma Y2B, here also it will come B, will be preferred over x1b comma x2b, right? Okay, so now what does this first two equation tells you about? It is telling us about that y allocation is feasible, right? And what is the next two equations saying? It is saying that it is preferred as compared to the x allocation. Y is preferred x compared to the x allocation. But by the hypothesis, we have a market equilibrium where each person is purchasing the best bundle they can afford, right? Which was this. But if Y allocation is better, then what A is purchasing, then if Y allocation is better than what person A was already purchasing, then it must be true that it cost more than what A can afford. Because in the market equilibrium, वी टेक द बेस्ट बंडल एंड इट एग्जॉस्ट आवर होल इनकम. सो इफ देयर इज एनी अदर बंडल विच वी हैव अज्यूम्ड हियर वाई वन कॉमा वाई टू, सो इट मस्ट हैव कॉस्ट मोर देन वट वी हैव कॉस्ट फॉर द एक्स वन एक्स टू. सिमिलर इट मीन्स दैट यू नीड मोर इनकम टू परचेज दिस बंडल इफ दिस इज प्रिफर्ड ओवर दिस, बिकॉज दिस इज ऑलरेडी पेरेटो एफिशियंट एंड योर होल इनकम हैज बिन कंज्यूम दिस इन कंज्यूमिंग दिस. सो इफ यू आर प्रिफरिंग अनदर बंडल, दैट मीन्स यू आर इनकरिंग सम मोर कॉस्ट. यू हैव टू इनकर सम मोर कॉस्ट टू गो टू दैट बंडल. वॉट डज इट इम्प्लाई दैट इट डजेंट इवन लाई इन द एजवर्थ बॉक्स, इट मे लाई आउटसाइड द एजवर्थ बॉक्स. ओके, सो एक्चुअली इन द थ्योरी इट्स ओवर, लाइक आई हैव टोल्ड यू फ्रॉम द थ्योरी पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू, बट इफ यू वॉन्ट टू सी इट फ्रॉम द न्यूमेरिकल ऑल्सो, वट विल हैपन फॉर वाई इफ यू हैव टू राइट इन न्यूमेरिकल फॉर्म, इट विल बी ग्रेटर देन द इनकम विच ही वॉज ऑलरेडी हैविंग, राइट. सिमिलरली फॉर द पर्सन टू, प्लस पी टू वाई टू बी इज ग्रेटर देन पी वन वाई वन डब्ल्यू वन बी प्लस पी टू डब्ल्यू टू पी. ओके, दिस इज फॉर पर्सन ए, दिस इज फॉर पर्सन बी. सो यू कैन क्लियरली सी दैट ही डजेंट हैव दैट मनी टू अफोर्ड दैट बंडल. दैट मीन्स दैट बंडल डजेंट लाई इन द इन योर एजवर्थ बॉक्स. सो इट इज अ क्लियर कॉन्ट्राडिक्शन, इट इज अ क्लियर कॉन्ट्राडिक्शन एंड वी गेट दिस कॉन्ट्राडिक्शन बाय वट वी हैव अज्यूम्ड अर्लियर दैट मार्केट इक्विलिब्रियम इज नॉट एफिशियंट. सो दिस वॉज आर अजम्पशन दैट मार्केट इक्विलिब्रियम इज नॉट एफिशियंट एंड इट हैज मेड अ कॉन्ट्राडिक्शन हेयर विच आई हैव टोल्ड यू. Therefore, it follows that market equilibrium is Pareto efficient. So, your first theorem ends here. Now, we will see what are the implications of first theorem. So, now if I tell you about the implication of first theorem, it will be that if I start from the starting. So, according to the first theorem, all market equilibrium are Pareto efficient. Okay, this we know. Although it is not based on any explicit assumption, there is no any explicit assumption that we are taking some other assumption while proving this. So we are not taking any explicit assumption, but we are taking some implicit assumption which is already implied. Okay. So the one of the implicit assumption is that economic agent care about their own consumption bundle, right? But they are not concerned about what others consume. Okay, this is the one implied assumption of first theorem. Because if they care about the if one economic agent is concerned about what other consume, then there is consumption externality. Okay, it can be shown that in the presence of externalities, competitive market equilibrium are not Pareto efficient, and this we will discuss afterwards. Okay, I will take the class on externality afterwards. Also, you know, if there is a, it's a common thing that if there is any externality, it doesn't have the equilibrium. Okay, like the equilibrium is not Pareto, there will be equilibrium, but it won't be Pareto efficient due to the externalities. That there are any external factors which are affecting the business and due to which he cannot produce that Pareto efficient output. So it won't lead to any Pareto efficient output, and we will discuss it in unit number 3. Okay. So now we move on to second implied assumption. So second implied assumption is that economic agent behave competitively. Okay. But if there are only two economic agent, then it is unlikely that they would take prices as given. Instead, they would use their market power to improve their position. And this is also easy one. Okay. So now we will move on to monopoly in the Edgeworth box. Okay, guys. So, okay, let me just write it down first. Monopoly in Edgeworth box. So now we stated that a competitive market shall be Pareto efficient. That is our first theorem. So this implies that if one or more condition for existence of perfect competition are violated, then the allocation mechanism shall not be Pareto efficient. Okay. So we now consider a resource allocation mechanism that does not lead to a Pareto efficient outcome. And we are taking our first case, that is monopoly. So there is no perfect competition. And in the first theorem, we implies that there was perfect competition. So if any condition for the perfect competition is violated, so then we will see what will be the mechanism, and the mechanism will not be Pareto efficient. So our first theorem will not hold. Okay, so let's start it. So let's assume that let there be two consumers in the market. Okay. That is consumer A and B. Okay, there are two consumers in the market. Consumer A acts as a monopolist and quotes price to B. Okay, given the prices set by B, consumer B shall decide his consumption behavior. It means that the prices will be given by A, and according to that, consumer B will decide his consumption behavior, that how will he going to consume, how much and whatever the equilibrium quantity will be. Okay, so we assume that consumer A is aware of demand demand function of the consumer B. Okay, this means that consumer A can be aware of price offer curve, because you know that from the price offer curve only we draw the our demand function, right? By joining the locus of the price offer curve, which is the demand function only, and you have studied this in your SEM 3 also. So this means that who is the monopolist? He has also the information of the price offer curve of the consumer B. Okay, because the demand curve is the locus of the different points of the price offer curve only. Okay, guys. Okay, so the POC of B shows all successive position of consumer B's equilibrium at different prices. That is the same thing, which is the definition of price offer curve only. Okay, also the definition for demand curve. So now consumer A would like to maximize his utility given the demand behavior of B. Therefore, A's equilibrium shall be attained when A's indifferent curve become tangent to POC of B. Okay, and now I will this explain in the diagram which I have told you just now. Okay, so this is the Edgeworth box. Let us consider this as a budget line. This is consumer B, this is consumer A, which is a monopolist now. So let us assume that this is the POC of B. POC of B. Okay, we have assumed that POC of B is like this. Okay, so now how will the A will maximize his consumption? How will it do that? How will A maximize his utility? So we have studied earlier, I have just told you that A's equilibrium shall be attained when A's indifference curve become tangent to POC. So now what will A do? A will draw the, wait, this is POC, this is a curve only. So A will draw tangent IC to the POC of B. So it will be like this, ICA, right? Similarly, at this point, IC of B is this one. So clearly, you can see that this is the allocation which A will use. This is IC B. Okay. So here you can see that IC of A is not tangent to IC B. It is clearly seen. And also, you can see from here also that there is a lens occurring. And whenever there is a lens, it means that it is not a Pareto efficient bundle, because he has maximized his consumption through the already known the POC of B. He knows the demand curve of B and according to that he maximizes his condition at that point IC of B is like this, and he is creating a lens, which means that there is breakdown of Pareto efficiency condition. Okay, so the existence of monopoly result in the allocation defined by point X, okay, and which is also Pareto inefficient. So if you see in this figure, there is a lens created region. If I mark this as XY, okay. So this lens is common between IC A and IC B, okay. It shows that both A and B can still be made better off. What is the Pareto efficient meaning? I already told you that no one can be better off that. I'll tell you that to make one better off, you have to make the other one worse off. So you cannot stay out of that condition. Okay, but here is a scope to better off one person, and we are not worsening off the another one. So here is a scope for increasing production of one without decreasing the production of two. That is what inefficiency is. And okay, so it shows that A and B can still be made better off, or at least see, both can be also better off by shifting their ICs, or at least one can be made better off without making anyone else worse off. Okay, so thus the monopoly allocation defined by X shall be Pareto inefficient. However, the ICB is tangent to the budget constraint. The ICA is not tangent to the budget constraint. That is, MRSA is not equal to MRSP. That is why it is not Pareto inefficient. Okay, so this was the case of Pareto inefficiency in the monopoly. So now, can you tell me about any case in which under monopoly only we can achieve the Pareto efficiency condition? You can relate it with the deadweight loss. See, earlier I have told you that in the uniform pricing there will be deadweight loss. Okay, but what will happen if you just follow the first degree price discrimination? You have seen earlier that there is no deadweight loss and whole surplus is of producers only, right? So what will happen if we apply first degree here also in the Edgeworth box? So this is the only case, first degree price discrimination is the only case in which you can achieve Pareto efficiency. So now I will take the case of first degree price discrimination. So now let's assume that consumer A is practicing first degree price discrimination. This is the one case where Pareto efficiency can be achieved under monopoly, as I already told you. So this is possible only when the monopolist practices first perfect price discrimination or first degree price discrimination. This is the one and the same thing. So under perfect price discrimination, the monopolist sells each unit of output at a maximum price the consumer is willing to pay, which is the reservation price. We have already done this. Okay, so at this price, consumer is indifferent between buying or not buying that unit of good. In this manner, the monopolist is able to capture the entire consumer surplus. It is the same thing which I taught you in the monopoly. Okay, so suppose in the above discussed case, where consumer A was the monopolist and was setting the price, had practiced perfect price discrimination. Okay, so now we are taking the same case which we took earlier. So now we will see how in the Edgeworth box it will lead to Pareto efficiency. Okay, so if I draw the diagram, this is the Edgeworth box, right? Okay, and this is ICB. Okay, and this is your IC. Okay guys, let's mark this as W. Okay, so now W is the initial endowment. I have marked it here. So now A sells 1 unit of good one to consumer B at the maximum price that consumer B is willing to pay. Now from this, what will happen? What it will do that consumer B will remain on the same IC because it is the maximum price he was willing to pay to consumer A. But A will shift upward. He will go to higher IC now. Yes. So this will be ICA2. Okay. So let's mark this point as F. Okay, guys. Now again, consumer A is selling one more unit to B. Okay. Also, if you see from here also, consumer one has sold 1 unit because he has gone from here to here. Now he is again selling one more unit at the maximum price which B is willing to pay. So again, B will remain on the same IC, but consumer A will move upward, shift to the higher IC. So this will be IC3, and let's mark this point as G. Okay, so this is the same procedure. So now I am finally, what will do? He will again, this process will go on until and unless it will become tangent to the, this is downward sloping, sorry. IC, let's name as IC4, and this is your E point. So he will go until he reach here. He won't go further that because if he go after that, he will start incurring losses. So he won't go after that. He has captured the whole surplus of the market, and also it has achieved the Pareto efficient outcome. Okay, so this was all about your monopoly in the Edgeworth box. Okay, guys. So now if I want to conclude that perfectly competitive equilibrium without externality will be Pareto efficient. Similarly, competitive market equilibrium with externality will be inefficient. Monopoly market equilibrium under uniform pricing will be inefficient. Monopoly market equilibrium under perfect price discrimination or first degree price discrimination will be Pareto efficient. Okay. So guys, this is all for today's class. In the next class, we will finish off this lecture by completing our general equilibrium. And there's only one topic left, which is second theorem of welfare economics, and which we will do in next class. So thank you guys for watching, and put your query in the comment section. I would be happy to help you. Okay guys, bye.